हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, वेल्कम बैक। माय सेल्फ पुष्पेंद्र सिंह एंड वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद अवर डेली करंट अफेयर्स। ओके, सो टुडे यू हैव द 1st of February 2021 एंड दीज क्लासेस आर बेसिकली मेंट फॉर दोज स्टूडेंट्स हु हैव प्रिपेयरिंग फॉर द गवर्नमेंट कॉम्पिटेटिव एग्जामिनेशंस एंड विच रिक्वायर टू स्टडी योर करंट अफेयर्स, राइट? सो दिस कोर्स इज मेंट फॉर दोज स्टूडेंट्स हु कैन ब्रश अप देयर करंट अफेयर्स, डेली करंट अफेयर्स थ्रू दीज लेक्चर्स। And we are basically referring to national newspapers. The first is The Hindu and the second is Indian Express. Okay, both of these newspapers are equally good. You can refer any of these newspapers. Okay, so let's begin with our lecture. Okay, so first is basically Patta Chitra. Okay, so Patta Chitra is basically an art. Okay, it's an art basically which is famous in Orissa and the West Bengal. Okay. So here the Prime Minister Narendra Modi in his Man Ki Baat program, okay, so referred this Patta Chitra. So he referred basically an example of a person called as Bhagyashri Sahu, right? The Bhagyashri Sahu basically belongs to Odisha and basically, you know, she is basically a student from Rourkela, which is basically a district in the Odisha, and she is basically having the keen interest in this painting, which is known as Patta Chitra painting. Okay, so what is that mean? Patta Chitra means, patta means you have cloth. Okay, so patta means you have cloth and chitra means you have picture. Okay, so cloth picture, that means a picture which is made up of, or which the picture which is made up on with the help of a cloth. That means a picture would be made on the piece of a cloth. Okay, so the Patta Chitra painting is basically famous in the West Bengal and in Orissa, both of these states. Okay, and this tradition is basically more famous in West Bengal around Kalighat, right, in the Kolkata, right, where, you know, the theme is not much devotional, which is basically referred to some other paintings. Okay, and second is basically the Odisha tradition. The Odisha tradition basically famous around the Puri. In the Puri, you have the famous Jagannath temple. Okay, so this tradition is basically famous or centered around Puri, and almost all of the painter community or the chitrakar community basically belongs to a small village in the Puri district. The village name is Raghurajpur. Okay, so the almost all of the painter community basically belongs to this village, which is known as Raghurajpur in the Puri district of Orissa. And these paintings, as I told you, that major difference between the Orissa and the West Bengal is the in the West Bengal painting, the theme is not much devotional, but in the Orissa, you know, tradition, the theme is devotional, right? So this painting are basically based on the Hindu mythology. Okay, especially, you know, since it is located or it is centered around the Puri, where Jagannath temple, world famous Jagannath temple is there. Okay, so it is inspired by the Jagannath and the Vaishnava sect, since it is located and centered, you know, on in and around Puri. Okay, and the colors basically used in this painting are natural, so no such synthetic colors are used, only the natural colors are used for making this painting on the piece of cloth. All right, you can see a Patta Chitra painting where Lord Jagannath is showing. All right, then next is National E Vidhan application, or that is called NEVA project. Okay, so what is this National E Vidhan application project? So you can say basically here, through it is a basically a mission mode project, which is also known as E Vidhan. Okay, through which a, you know, certain set of digital connectivity, right, in the Vidhan Sabha or in the, you know, secretary, basically in the assembly or in the, you know, legislative councils, basically will be connected through some sort of a digital connectivity. Okay, so this program was already implemented by the government of India. So here the news regarding this E Vidhan project is the Meghalaya State Assembly Speaker visited the Arunachal Pradesh Legislative Assembly Secretariat, right, which is located in the Itanagar, right, to get the information about this National E Vidhan project, which is implemented in the assembly, right? So the news basically relevant to his visit, who is basically, you know, the Assembly Speaker who visited Arunachal Pradesh recently. Okay, so this E Vidhan is basically a mission mode project which is included under Digital India program, which was, implemented by the Ministry of Parliamentary Affairs. So Ministry of Parliamentary Affairs basically is a nodal ministry. okay, for implementation of e-Vidhan project, okay, in all of the states and the union territories which is having the legislature. All right. And regarding the funding mechanism of this program is basically, you know, it is basically on the pattern of central sponsored scheme. For example, in the normal states, okay, the funding is basically 60% would be brought from the center and 40% would be brought from state. Okay, in the northeastern states and the hilly states, the pattern are significantly different, 90% from the center and 10% from the states. Okay, and especially in the union territories, which is having the legislative assembly, 100% would be brought from, you know, from the center only. All right. So, you know, the funding for e-Vidhan project is basically provided by the Ministry of Parliamentary Affairs. Okay, the technical support for this program was provided by the Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology, which is known as MeITY, okay, which will be providing the technical support. So this is the theme where the digital parliament or the digital connectivity will be provided to the legislative chambers. All right, next, the Matua. Matua is basically a community, okay, which is lying in the West Bengal. So this community basically lying across the border, across the international border, especially in the West Bengal region. Okay, so the Matua community in the news because recently, you know, the Amit Shah rally is going to be conducted. Okay, but because of some reasons, the Amit Shah rally or the Union Home Minister's rally was cancelled. Right. So this Matua community members basically upset. Right. With this move of cancellation of the rally, which was scheduled right in the border region of your West Bengal. Okay. So the Matua community members basically reside, as I told you, on the either side of the Bengal border. Okay. On the either side of the Bengal border, the Matua community reside. And this basically associated with, or the community basically associated with, a religious movement. This religious movement was started in 1970, and it was started by a person known as Harichandra Thakur of Namasudra family, right, which belongs to scheduled caste. Okay, so he was basically belongs to a SC family or a Namasudra family. Okay, the person named Harichandra Thakur, who basically started or propagated this movement or this religious movement. And this person basically belongs to the Safal Danga in the East Bengal, right, which is currently a part of the West Bengal. Okay, and in the early 20th century, right, his son Guru Chand organized the movement, right, at the social level as well as at the political level. So the movement basically, you know, reinvigorated the persons socially and the politically. Okay, and with this effort, in 1915, a Mathua Federation was formed. Right. And today, if you consider in terms of your census figure, the Mathua community basically constituted the second largest scheduled caste population in the West Bengal. Right. So the Mathua basically constituted the second largest SC population in the Bengal. And it basically, you know, constitute around 17% of the state's electorate. Right. So the Mathua community basically constitute around 17%. So 17% of the voters belongs to the Mathua community, which is a large, right? 17% is a good number, right? And the Mathua, since the Mathuas are basically, you know, reside, you know, on the board, on the both side of the border, right, in the West Bengal, right? Or some Mathuas also reside in the basically Bangladesh side also. So there is a continuous migration of these peoples. All right. So these Mathuas are basically demanding the amendment in the Citizenship Act. Okay. So that they can easily get into, you know, a citizenship from a refugee status. Okay, so for those people or for those Mathua community members who are basically considered as a refugees, right, would get the citizenship if the citizenship amendment basically enables the Mathua community to get membership of or the citizenship of India. Okay, you can see basically the members belongs to the Mathua community and it is a religious movement, right? All right, next. Next is Robin Hood app. Okay, so Robin Hood app is basically named, right, as a basically trading app, right, which will be used by, you know, by the members or by, you know, normal people, right, for, you know, trading purpose, just like the normal stock exchanges we used to do, right, in the stock market. So here you can basically use this online trading app which is named as Robin Hood. Okay, it is having some sort of a cultural significance or cultural phenomena. Okay. And the most important point here is that in the Silicon Valley, the Robinhood app want to, you know, Robinhood have basically promised to wrest the stock market away from the Wall Street traditional gatekeepers. So there is some sort of, you know, the famous for controlling and regulating this stock market, right? This promise is basically to wrest that control, right? And let the people trade in the stock market, right? So ultimate power lies with the people and based on that framework, okay? The person who are involved in the Robinhood app basically is an Indian American billionaire who is basically known as Baiju Prafulla Bhatt, who basically born in 1984, and he was basically an entrepreneur of Gujarati descent. That means he hails from the Gujarat, right? He went there and he basically, set up this online trading app. Along with that, he is a co-founder. Along with that, a Vladimir Tenev, right? Which is basically a US-based financial service agency. So this is basically, the Vladimir Tenev, also a co-founder of a Robinhood app. And as I told you, it is an American financial service company. This company is basically headquartered as Menlo Park in California. California is a state in United States of America. All right. And what happens on the January 28th, 2021, the Robinhood basically restricted the trading of certain stock, right? Why it is restricting? Because certain people basically made an effort to drive up their price, right? These users belongs to the Wall Street and the subreddit. So what happens is this move has led to the condemnation from internet users on the subreddit and on the Twitter. So which is also most important, the phenomena in that respect. And this is basically a Robinhood app. You can also look into your Google Play Store. All right. So Red Fort. Next news is basically related to your Red Fort. So here, the Red Fort, you might have heard about the Red Fort news also. The people or the farmers basically, entered into the Red Fort and unfurled basically the flag, which belongs to the Nissan Sahib, okay, on the pole, which was normally reserved for hosting the national flag, okay. So as the Prime Minister Narendra Modi also says that it was the day which was shamed for this, for this incident, right? So here the news basically related to All right. So the news basically related to the Red Fort, where you know the flag was basically unfurled by Nishan Sahib, right? So here the climax was basically raising of this Nishan Sahib on the pole, okay, which was normally reserved for the hosting of national flag by the Prime Minister during the Independence Day celebrations, right? So a lot of protests is basically held in the in and around Delhi, right? Especially at the borders of Delhi, and these people or farmers basically entered the central Delhi as well as you know into the Red Fort, and which basically caused some sort of a, you know, destructions to the property also. Okay, about this Red Fort. So Red Fort was basically built or commissioned by the Emperor Shah Jahan, who was basically a Mughal ruler, right? So construction was begin basically, you know, the of the Red Fort basically on 12th May 1638, right? When the Shah Jahan was deciding to shift his capital from Agra to Delhi. All right. So at that point of the time, the emperor basically commissioned the construction of Red Fort, and originally the Red Fort was basically red and white, and the design for the Red Fort is credited to an architect, Ustad Ahmed Lahori, right? And this person also, you know, constructed the Taj Mahal also, right? And the construction for this Red Fort basically took from the May 1639 to April 1648, all right? And during the reign of Shah Jahan, who was basically a Mughal ruler between 1628 and 1658, right? The Mughal connection or the Mughal connectivity with the Delhi was significantly improved, right? Because of the foundation of the city known as Shahjahanabad, right? So due to the, you know, foundation of the city Shahjahanabad, as well as the inauguration of the citadel where, you know, the emperor used to live in the Red Fort in 1648, which has led to the further connectivity to the Delhi, right, from Agra, right? And here, you know, till date of the extinction of, you know, the Mughal rule in 1857, right, the Delhi was basically a capital of the Mughal emperor up to that point of the time. Okay, so you can see here the Red Fort, where, you know, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru is basically, you know, having, you know, unfurling basically your the national flag on the rampant of your Red Fort. All right, next is antifreeze. Okay, so antifreeze is basically a chemical, first of all. So this is the chemical which we generally used, right, in the consumer products. Okay, so the antifreeze chemicals are basically accidentally, you know, ingested by the US soldiers, right? So which has led to, you know, the sickness among the US soldiers. So 11 such US soldiers basically fall sick after accidentally ingesting or drinking this ethylene glycol, because the taste of the ethylene glycol is a sweeter, which is a basically, you know, sometimes do not recognize that it is an anti-freezing chemical agent, or it is something like sweetener which we can consume, right? So because of that, accidentally consuming, the 11 US soldiers basically fall ill, right? Regarding this ethylene glycol, which is a anti-freezing, you know, a chemical, basically having the tremendous applications or diverse applications in the industrial compound, right? Consumer products, you can say basically the ethylene glycol basically used in the automotive industries, the hydraulic brake fuels, right? Making of stamp pads, inks, ballpoint pens, solvents, paints, plastics, films, cosmetics, and sometimes it is also used in the pharmaceutical vehicles also, right? So here the antifreeze is basically having a chemical compound which is not good or which is injurious to the health if it is ingested, okay? And this synthetic fluid, which is an odorless fluid, right, and which is used to make anti-freezing or de-icing solutions for the car, aeroplanes, and the boats. You might have heard about sometime in the, you know, in the Siberian region, where you have to do certain set of anti-freezing activities or de-icing activities or some solutions, right, for the airplanes, boats, and cars. This synthetic liquid would be used. And as I told you that ethylene glycol is basically a sweet test, and sometimes we often accidentally or intentionally ingested this fluid, right? And this ethylene glycol, once ingested into the body, right, it basically chemically broken down into the toxic compounds. So after breaking down, it basically converted into the toxic compounds, and this has led to certain byproducts which affect our central nervous system, okay, our heart and kidneys. So after ingesting it, it generally broken down into the toxic components, and these toxic components are basically injurious to the nervous system, to the heart and to the kidneys. Okay. And if we consume this ethylene glycol in the sufficient amount, right, it can be fatal also. So it can kill us also. And the ethylene glycol can be disseminated through the indoor air, water, food, and outdoor air, and the agricultural products. All right. So you can see it is the ethylene glycol, which basically used as an anti-freezing agent. Okay. Next is the UK special visa scheme for the Hong Kong residents. Okay. So first of all, you must understand Hong Kong was a UK, it was a UK territory, right? So UK ruled this Hong Kong region, right? So what happens is the people basically residing in the Hong Kong, because Hong Kong now is controlled by China, right? So what is happening there is, pro-democracy protest is going on in the Hong Kong, and China is basically, basically controlling that protest through a firm hand, and which is causing, some sort of a protest in the Hong Kong region. And though the Britain is basically a democracy, right? The Britain is basically support that movement in the Hong Kong region, but there is certain issues regarding the visa. So recently the UK has opened, right, a special visa scheme through which the residents of the Hong Kong, right, basically they can migrate to the UK or United Kingdom, and they can apply subsequently for the British citizenship. So it is basically only for those people who is having the British national overseas passport. Okay, only those residents of the Hong Kong which is holding the British national passport or overseas passport, right, and or their immediate dependents also, like for example for their wife, children, and etc., so that they can basically fast track, the UK citizenship, or they can fast track apply for the UK citizenship. Okay, so those applicants who is holding the British national overseas passport, they can get, some sort of a job, so they can live and they can work in the UK for 5 years, and after 5 years they can apply for the settlement where they can apply for the citizenship, right? So that means after 5 years, right, after completing the 12 months, they can apply for the citizenship and they can easily get the citizenship. Okay, this move of the UK, which allow the Hong Kong residents, right, which is holding the British, the Britain, overseas passport, right, here it is considered as a generous move, right, from the UK side of welcoming the foreign workers since the entry of new EU citizenship, right, in 2004, where 10 countries basically, added to that bloc when UK was also a member. So it was considered as a generous bloc, a step from the UK to allow the foreign, people or foreign workers in our country. And this move of providing this special arrangement basically comes after the China imposed, some sort of a national security law over the Hong Kong, which was a former British colony, right? Ultimate aim of imposing this, the national security law, was to control this pro-democracy protest, okay? So to control this pro-democracy protest, okay, the basically British or Britain is allowing those people to come to UK and get the citizenship of UK, right? These pro-democracy protests basically captured the global attention because of this China's imposition of the national security law over Hong Kong. Okay, you can see it is a political map of Hong Kong. Okay, you can see the Hong Kong territories. All right, next, Burgess. Okay, so here again, the elections are due, or legislative assembly elections are due in the West Bengal. So here, All India Trinamool Congress, which is basically currently a ruling party in the West Bengal. Okay, this party basically started using this word, Burgi, right? So Trinamool Congress is basically using this word Burgi, right, to attack the Bharatiya Janata Party. All right, so the All India Trinamool Congress considered the Bharatiya Janata Party in the West Bengal as a outsider, So the word Burgi was, to call the BJP, right, as the outsider, right, within the West Bengal, right, and it is having certain significance attached to the 16th and the 17th century, right, or in the 18th century when, the Marathas basically invaded the West Bengal between specifically 1741 and 1751, and the Marathas basically looted, you know, the best Bengal. And it was on that time, it was a Mughal territory, and Marathas basically plundered, looted, massacres, right? The Bengalis, that point of the time. So that reference was used as a Burgis for those Marathas invaders. So now the Burgi, which will be used against the Bharatiya Janata Party, right, which is considered as an outsider, and which is also considered as a, you know, the BJP is coming to West Bengal as for the looting and for plundering purpose. Okay. And the word Burgi having the specific, you know, the Bengali's consciousness, right, which is, you know, some sort of a having the presence in the Bengali's folklore and the literature. And the Burgi is basically, you know, referred as a troublesome outsider forces. Okay. So here the BJP will be considered as a troublesome outsider forces by using this Burgis, right, you know, specifically referred for the BJP in the West Bengal. Okay. So simply the Burgi were basically used in the 18th century, referred to the cavalryman. Cavalryman means the person who basically, you know, rode a horse, right? Or the persons or the fighters basically who rode a horse and came to, you know, for invasion purpose, right? So the person who is riding the, or who is having the horse, these cavalry persons basically belongs to the Marathas specifically. Okay. And the word basically came from the Persian word bargir, which means a burden taker, right? So these persons are basically considered as a burden taker and came to the Bengal for various looting purpose. All right. And the Burgi is basically the term which basically used a soldier who rode a horse furnished by his employer. That means a Marathas. All right. So you can see the person or the Burgi is basically riding a horse. He is basically considered as a Burgi or outsider. All right. Next is India-Chile relationships. Okay. So in the same speech, Pradhan Mantri's Mann Ki Baat address on January 31st, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi basically spoke about the yoga, right? The yoga, which is, you know, we also celebrate the yoga, and UN also recognize, you know, the yoga by declaring the International Yoga Day. All right. So the popularity of yoga is basically increasing in Latin American countries also. For example, the Chile, which basically, the Chile has integrated the yoga into their culture by declaring a National Yoga Day on 4th of the November every year. All right. So here, the Prime Minister Narendra Modi basically spoke about the popularity of the yoga in some of the Latin American countries, right, like Chile. And the Chile is basically, you know, known for the declaring of the yoga, right, on the 4th of November as a National Yoga Day. And regarding the Chile, right, on 4th of November 1962, the first yoga institution in the Chile was established by Jose Rafael Estrada, right? This Estrada or Jose Rafael Estrada basically belongs to the Mexico, and he is credited with the bringing of yoga to the Chile, which is basically a Latin American country. And the Prime Minister Narendra Modi also referred the Rabindranath Quinteros, right? He is the person who is basically a vice president of the Chilean Senate in the basically also referred his, you know, name in his Mann Ki Baat speech. Okay. And the Rabindranath Quinteros basically inspired by the Vishwa Kavi Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore, right, for his, you know, contribution to this, you know, yoga. So the Prime Minister Narendra Modi also used his name called Rabindranath Quinteros, who is basically a vice president of Chilean Senate. Okay, you can see here, it is basically, you know, a country which belongs to, you know, here you see basically it is a Southern America. Okay, so you see here it is a Southern America, and it is basically a country called Chile. Okay, so it is basically, you know, the located on the South Pacific Ocean, right, on the margin of South Pacific Ocean or the eastern side of the South Pacific Ocean. All right. Next, silk. Okay, as you know that India is basically the second largest producer of the silk in the world. Okay, so the Union Textile Minister Smriti Zubin Irani inaugurated the India International Silk Fair, which is, you know, inaugurated, you know, this silk fair virtually. That means there is no such physical outlets or, you know, the outlets which is generally there. So this, you know, the International Silk Fair would be inaugurated virtually online. It is the 8th edition of such silk fair, and this fair is considered as a India's biggest silk fair, right? Under, you know, under the roof of India's Indian Silk Export Promotion Council, which is a body which is basically responsible for promotion of the export of the silk from the Indian manufacturer, right? So it will be inaugurated on the virtual platform from 31st of January to 4th of February 2021. So this India International Silk Fair would be conducted virtually on the virtual platform, all right, from 31st of January to 4th of February 2021. And the India International Silk Fair is basically a sourcing fair for the silk, right? Basically, which is organized by the India Silk Export Promotion Council. All right, so silk related products will be try to be sourced out from the India, right, through this Indian Silk Export Promotion Council. And this silk fair basically inaugurated under the aegis of Ministry of Textile, and this is basically sponsored by the Department of Commerce, because ultimate aim is to export this silk related products from the India. Okay, and as you know that Indian silk and the Muslims are basically very famous, right? In the 16th, 17th, and 18th century also. So India has a long history of silk production. Okay, and currently India is the second largest producer of the silk in the world. And India is the only country in the world which produces all four major varieties of the silk. So there are four major varieties of the silk, right? India produces all four major varieties of the silk, like mulberry, which is the one variety, eri, tasar, and the muga. These are the four varieties of the silk which is currently produced in India. Okay, and India has around 11 geographical indications, right, which is associated with different type of silk. For example, this GI tag have been given for Pochampally Ikat silk, then Chandrapol silk, then Mysore silk, then Kanchipuram silk, Muga silk, Salem silk, Arni silk, Champa silk, Bhagalpur silk, Banaras brocade silk, and the saris, right? So this is basically associated with the geographical indications. Geographical indications are given to those products which are having the specific geographical identity, right? So that these geographically indicated products can be outsourced or can be basically exported with a uniform quality, right? So it will basically indicate that it is a qualitative measure to export those products from the particular geographical region, right? So that it can basically promote the exports of this product from the particular geographical region. So you can see these are basically the silk, the items, probably the saris, which are basically used for the promotion in the basically India International Silk Fair. All right. So thank you very much for attending this session. We'll meet again tomorrow for our next current affairs tomorrow at, in the morning for the 2nd of February 2021. So thank you very much. Till then, thank you.